Suara Inspirasi, where every voice tells a story, and every story will inspire you.
So, welcome everybody. Today we have a very, very special guest, an entrepreneur that has, how do I put it? The serial or most serialist entrepreneurs.
Exactly.
Nadira behind us. So, Sunil and I are at the golf course today for a reason. Right?
Nadira, can you give us the pleasure to tell us why we're at the golf course?
Well, decades ago, I used to be a Malaysian player. So I was a Malaysian golfer, Malaysian national golfer.
Wow. Okay. There you go.
A long time ago.
Small little things that you don't know about Nadira.
Yeah. Fun facts. Yes, I play golf for Malaysia. I represent Malaysia at the international meet. So I won a couple of, championship tournaments around. One of the most significant ones, I think, was the China Ladies Open, and I became the champion.
Wow.
Was in school there.
Wow. Look at that, man.
Wow.
Very competitive in nature. Everything also I want to play.
Okay, wait. So were you competitive because you were competitive, or someone put you through, hey, you've got to be a golf player? Was it you choosing to do that, or your parents put you through it?
Well, I think I was always very competitive in nature. You know, in school, kan, I was very athletic. So any sports I can, put my foot in, I would lah. And then every time I play something, I say I'm gonna win, right? I will do that. But golf was accidental, I think, because my parents.
I was just
parents,
about to ask you. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, why would a 12-year-old girl actually want to go and?
You were 12.
At that time, wow. Right? At that time when I started, I was 12.
Same.
It was way back in Morib, tau. You can imagine, kan? There was just a 9-hole, of course, in Morib at that time. But my parents were playing golf, and my sister and I, we got sick of actually, spending too long a time at the swimming pool.
Okay.
And then one day they were, the pros and driving range say, "Eh, try lah." And then try lah. Rupanya pandai.
Wow.
And then we got absorbed into the National Junior Golf Leagues and whatnot.
So it's a nice segue, right? Mm. We had a discussion prior to this recording in terms of the mentality of that winner's mindset is actually, I guess, something that is innate, right?
Mm. It starts early.
It starts early. It's one of the most important entrepreneurial traits.
Correct.
Mm. It's playing to win, not play, not to lose, right?
Exactly. Yes. And right, like she rightly said, yeah, being competitive, right? She had that urge at 12, right? So
yes.
competitive.
She haven't stopped being competitive, lah.
No, I don't. Up to the extent where, business is not enough, I want to compete in Muay Thai now.
You see? She's competing in Muay Thai, literally, the real fight.
And I also understand you have a center, right?
Yes, I do. I love it so much that I thought, since I'm fighting and I love it, why don't I invest in it?
so I can get the best
of both worlds.
All right. Okay. Coincidentally, my kids do golf as well, and all three are in karate. And it's probably because of my interest as well.
Right.
And they
yes.
seem to enjoy it. So let's see where it takes them.
Yeah, but I think that's important, having that right kind of support. And I think I also attribute my, my competitiveness and ability to actually do that kind of competition, kan, because my parents were very supportive of me. Lah.
Okay. I think end of the day, parent support is also important to, in a way, push the kids. And
kind of support system
exactly,
is important.
Exactly. Without that, you really don't have the urge and continuity over there.
Correct.
Which is a nice segue. You're talking about kids?
Yeah.
Nadira, what exactly do you, other than the fact that you are a pro golfer, you are a fighter, Muay Thai fighter, and other things that we're going to find out as we're having this chat, right? So what do you do today as an entrepreneur?
Well, today I run Kiddocare. So I started Kiddocare and I'm running it into our fifth year right now. And Kiddocare is a platform, if anyone doesn't know, it's a platform that connects parents earlier on with trained and qualified childcare service providers. But we have recently also evolved to supporting families in all their care needs. So that's also providing elderly care support, mental health care support, all those kind of things.
So what made you decide to do it?
I'm a mommy, Adli.
I'm gonna turn and look at you. Yeah, so sorry, camera guys. We're gonna,
right?
Focus on entrepreneur.
So,
I got to focus in the road, yeah?
So. We knew that. Dude, we should have closed our eyes. Focus on me, close your eyes. You should close your eyes.
Okay, all right. No way, go ahead, guys.
So it was funny because I think, the universe just brings everything together. So I think, I had that idea of you know, trying to get that kind of support kan, for me as a mother since much earlier lah, right? Tapi I always thought that, you know, the time was not right, right, to start something like this. So in 2018, since I was also working with a lot of women's organization tau, and then you know, as a mom of six, right,
being of
a
six,
yes, six.
She's always a champion, like,
in everything. In everything, six, yeah?
So competitive.
All right, my God,
wow. I compete with myself.
Gender, all the six gender, boys, girls,
and four girls, two boys.
Okay,
wow. Yeah, I hope, you know, at some point I settle down in the line that.
I hope, is it?
I hope.
It could be eight next year, you know.
But anyways, going back to that story, right? So, a mother, and I was also a single mother, you know, when I started my journey, and then throughout my journey also. And then, you know, it was really hard, you know, trying to manage. I cannot even say balance, but managing, you know, household, children, and then businesses. True. I started business also very young. And in 2018, when I was working a lot with women's organization, and at that time, the government wanted to introduce, they actually introduced the Women Empowerment Year.
Yep. Okay.
2018.
Yep. Okay. Yep.
Right?
Exactly.
Right.
And there were so many programs like, jom kita bagi mesin jahit. Okay, let's give, you know, mesin jahit to women, get them more involved in business.
Traditional,
right? But I said, okay, good, but we're going to fall back to that same old question of whether or not they can continue, they can progress, they can advance, because it is always that, right? Who's going to take care of their loved ones? Because building a business needs commitment.
That's true.
Right? You really do need a support system. And then when I was looking at, you know, how I was actually struggling with my own support system, right? There wasn't anything that was, you know, made to fit our kind of lifestyle, Dom. So at that time, I thought, kalau tak boleh, biasalah kan, entrepreneur kan. If you can't find a solution, you build right?
Yeah,
so exactly. I think it's like, you know, most of startups and everything, you actually focus on the gaps. I guess that's where you saw the gap really was, and how you're going to handle that, and how you're going to tackle that. And that probably had an igniting thing for you. And you said, all right.
It was something so personal to me.
Okay.
At the same time, you know, because I really wanted to do something very significant. I mean, I've been in businesses in technology, and I was working with women. It only makes sense to use technology to really try to come in and solve this problem, right? So I did that.
I mean, it's funny, right? In life, entrepreneurs, because some are natural entrepreneurs, so Nadira clearly comes across as a natural entrepreneur, or natural born one.
Yeah, right.
You would do things that you want to do because I think at the beginning you want to do something because you saw, okay, there's an opportunity to make some money here, right? And then as you get older, you realize, you know, I want to do something that I love, and if I can make money doing it, why not?
Yeah.
And it sounds exactly what Kiddocare is about, right? She's finally found a huge passion.
Not only the gap, I think the passion that she has in with kids, and also resonates on you very well, right? I guess.
I guess. I hope so. No, but I think it was more of, you know, ensuring that we do have the support system. It was also this desire in me, tau. Macam, I was sick and tired of people talking about, let's empower women.
Yes.
Without really looking into that core problem that was really affecting them, right? So I thought, we cannot just say that, you know, we're going to be empowering women, giving them jobs and things like that. But they're still not going back to workforce. They're still not progressing. We're still not, you know, getting more women in the leadership and things like that, right?
Yeah.
So itulah, it's that desire. Like, everything just came together.
So just holding on to that fact, in terms of you've done multiple businesses, and I'll get to how the previous business had challenges too, which we will go in the next segment after the break. But in your experience doing Kiddocare, do you find, because you have the passion, is it that little bit easier in terms of trying to, you know, trying to get things off the ground, trying to get people a little bit more, you know, into the business versus doing something because, hey, it's an opportunity, I think I can make some money, I'm going to sort of hit the wall?
I think it was definitely a passion, purpose, and experience, right, from running previous businesses.
But I'm sure you faced lots of challenges at the beginning and all that. And how overwhelming was it, and how did you handle that? You know, I mean, up, down, you know, and is it going to work? Am I doing the right decision? Did I, you know, finally...
Well, you know, to be very honest with you, I did think about discontinuing Kiddocare in 2021.
Just a few years ago, I almost did.
Wow. Right? It was very tough. I mean, nobody actually knew about this until we overcame that situation, and I was willing to share the story with even my staff. They didn't know about it, right?
And how many staff do you have at that time?
At that time, we had about 12, maybe, right?
It's tough, right? Putting a face in front and, you know, giving the courage and giving the confidence to everyone while you are inside. How am I going to do
it
that?
It was. I mean, you know, a lot of challenges along the way. In the beginning, as in any kind of innovative businesses, right? I mean, you go into an area where it's great.
Yeah.
You know, there's no regulation, there's no policies and things like that. But, you know, that's what we do. We look into gray areas and we try to make sure that we build something, you know, better, right? But because of that also, and we're dealing with childcare, right? It's a very sensitive, very highly regulated businesses. So it's very difficult in the beginning to also get government support. Right? So, since we're going to go and, you know, make this available for the public, I tak cerita banyak sangat lah.
Let me just set back a little bit. You're talking about, you know, the difficulties. You know, it's quite regulated, this industry.
Yes. Hmm.
And, you know, I'm sure the issues facing governmental issues, statutory requirements and all that. How did you actually handle that work? And, you know, how was the experience like, you know, trying to do something at the same time not getting support or getting support? And maybe you could share a little bit of that, and especially in the government sector, and what were you facing?
Well, two things, right? Number one, not getting support. Number two, realizing that in business, right, there will be times when you cannot get support, what you're going to do.
And you're going to be alone, right?
Yeah, you're going to be alone, but you're going to do. So in the beginning, when we, you know, came out with this type of business model, you know, new, you know, not in the regulation. So it was also something new from the government side also. You know, how do we view this? I can't blame them entirely for not supporting us, because I think they were also in that, you know, conundrum lah. Maybe how do we even support them, because we don't fall under this, right?
Right.
So, but it was on us because we wanted to make sure that we are able to do this. So, we had to do a lot of work. So, we had to benchmark against what's available around the world. I put in a team of researchers. I put in a team of advisors, you know, childcare experts and whatnot, and built all the SOPs, the training modules. But we had a long journey of actually having to go back to the government and present our cases, present our modules and things like that. It wasn't easy lah, you know. Getting buy-in from the government is one, but also getting the market punya readiness to accept this kind of service, where, you know, having our caregivers to go into the houses, but also the caregivers. So, you know, before this, there was nothing like this.
Yeah.
How can I trust even my safety to go into a house of strangers that I don't even know, right? So there were three things that was challenging that we had to address at once, right? And not forgetting the money lah to start.
Which I was waiting for that, right? No, but you had a multifaceted problem. You had to create demand. You also had to find supply and train them.
Yes.
Which didn't exist before you...
Nope. So yeah, I think, you know, that's where experience comes in, right?
I don't know what I'm doing. Let's just do it. You're the entrepreneur. It's okay lah. We fly the plane.
Let me be the first.
That's the experience.
Right? Yeah, it's
lah.
Naive, right?
That's the experience.
Right,
okay.
Yeah.
Because like, okay, you know, if nobody has done this before, this is indeed an opportunity.
Okay.
Right. Because nobody can tell us whether it's right or wrong.
True.
Right.
But you create the benchmark.
We create a benchmark. We create a standard. So we love that. I mean, I love that opportunity of having to create that standard. Right?
Okay.
I want to be the first. Sama lah, macam competition.
Again, your intuition and your competitiveness come in.
Yes.
Just one little question, right? So you started in 2019. Why? How did it all started? Why was 2019?
So 2018 was the women empowerment year, right? That they wanted to do that. And I was, you know, I said I wanted to do something very significant, right? And here I was trying to solve this problem, and I wanted something sustainable. I didn't want it to become just a program. I wanted it to be sustainable, and it has to be a business venture lah, to be sustainable.
Okay.
But it was also, I think, the right time, right? Because I've been in businesses before, right? I regularly failed in some of my business venture for being too innovative at that time.
We do, right? Entrepreneurs do. We keep on failing and failing and failing until we succeed, right?
Correct. But you know, I think the timing was right. Number one, I think I must also attribute this to the likes of Grab and Uber, kan?
Okay.
Because I think the public, the consumers were more open to accepting, you know, services through an app. Right, getting into a car of a stranger, you know, that kind of thing, and using an app to make booking. So we knew that, you know, although the nature of our business is different, it's going to be another set of challenges, but at least, you know, that kind of app is already something that our consumers can get used to. So because the technology is more receptive, right? It's just about putting in a new type of business and building that kind of safety.
And changing the mindset of people as well.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
Getting the traction, I think that was a challenge, but you know, somehow or other doing it again and again and
correct.
Again.
Correct. And but the needs was there, right? I mean, mothers wanted to go back to work. We have more, you know, affluent younger generation and more driven. They wanted to go and, you know, build their careers for themselves. So I think it was just nice. The timing was right.
Okay. Mm. Interesting. Maybe, Adeline, you want to discuss
about it? Yeah. I want to touch on, before we go on to the depth of the business, you mentioned something interesting, Nadira, regarding you had to build multimodal marketplaces, you had to do government, you know, relations.
Mm.
And at the same time, you mentioned this, which is the most important thing, which is the lifeblood of a startup, which is money.
Yeah.
Mm.
Right. So, how did it start in 2019? What did you raise? How did you bootstrap? Did you raise, you know, venture capital immediately?
Okay, so you know, in my previous businesses, I never had to raise any money, right? So, so this kind of business model was something very new to me also, right? Having to raise money. So in the beginning, I was like, okay, let's not do this. Let's use our own money. So, you know, fork out money from my own pocket lah. I was quite lucky because I had other businesses to support, kan? So, okay, use our own money. And I actually didn't think about going into that fundraising route lah.
Okay.
But
so that was not your initial thought, yeah?
No, no, it wasn't. In 2019, early 2019, no, it wasn't. But then the demand actually just grew, right? I think over 6 months macam tu into the business, the demand grew tau. So we said, hey, we cannot keep doing this because we have to start building our technology. We faked our technology before we started, of course. You know, we said we were the first mobile, you know, care services, but we were just using WhatsApp and Google Form, right?
Fake it till you make it.
Make it there, okay.
Yeah, exactly,
yeah.
Right, right.
And then every month, we were getting good traction. We were, you know, revenue was increasing. Demand was really shooting. So we said, hey, tak boleh lah. We have to start building our technology. And that requires a lot of learning in terms of our services, customers, SOP, kan? So we have to build this fast. And we needed money to be able to do that. Right?
So you were a bit different, right? So you basically created the demand before you created the technology. Whereas a lot of, and we got to share this, right? A lot of startups nowadays, you know, they're too focused on creating the technology before getting the traction.
I had that passion of, you know, moments before that, okay. Of creating the technology. I thought was the coolest and everybody was going to get it.
And only the technology is So that's another story. So I still want to focus on Kiddocare. That one you have to highlight later. Yeah, you've got to hear that story.
Right. But yeah, so because of experience, again, I knew, you know, whatever it is, you know, get the market first, you know, show that traction, you know, make sure we have the demand and the supply because we have to, you know, balance both, right? Then only we started building technology. But it was very crucial also because we can't build the technology without understanding the business requirements.
That's
right?
Exactly.
So that's what we did. But waktu nak masuk fundraising tu, who do we go to, right? People were talking about, okay, let's go VCs, right?
And this is 6 months in?
6 months in.
Okay, before VC, you use your own balance sheet to invest.
Yes.
How much, do you remember how much you actually spent to get it from 0 to 6 months?
0 to 6 months, I think it was about 200,000 quid.
What, that's 200,000 of your own pocket money, you know?
Yes, 200,000. Because, yeah, we had to build the modules for the training. We had to get in the advisors and the experts. So it was that kind of investment in the first place, like creating the standards.
Mainly you?
call me.
I mean, you probably I mean, that's the amount of confidence you have, and you know, do it or die, you know, that kind of stuff, right?
Yes. So, at that time, okay, would we go to, you know, the ecosystem? Friends were telling me go to VCs, right? So I did try. I went up, pergi jumpa VC, but got shut down lah the first time, kan?
Biasalah tu, kan?
How many VCs did you meet?
I met about 20, kot. Not so many, but I think at 9K. That point of time, I thought, enough lah, right? Like I thought, this is not going to work, right? So I said, okay lah, tak apa, let's go to crowdfunding.
Okay.
Right? So I had people telling me, don't go crowdfunding. And then, you know, I had other people telling me, but that's your only choice, you know, that kind of thing. And I thought, you know, crowdfunding ni, the good thing is, if I, because we're a consumer-based business, kan? So if I can't get the money, I probably get word of mouth.
Yeah.
I won't lose, right?
Okay. So I went either or, there is something.
Yes. So we did lah the crowdfunding round. And I think 3 months into our crowdfunding journey, we were oversubscribed.
Wow. And this is without you. This is natural, organic people just subscribing to.
Yes, just natural, wow, organic people.
Which was the
people.
Platform you were using at that time?
We went on Pitchit.
Okay. Okay.
So yeah, I think we had more people actually, you know, appreciating what we're trying to do. So that was our first fundraiser in 2019, end of 2019.
How much was that?
We raised about 700,000, close to 800.
Wow. Whoa. And fast forward today, you know, how many investors you have with you? And
I have quite a few investors now.
Okay.
We just closed our last round.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I think in October last year. And we have Gobi Dana Impact now. We have an investor from Singapore, MSWV, also another one, Quest Ventures. We have Scale Up. We have apa nama ni, Artem as our Artem Ventures as our investors. So.
Total you've raised so far?
Total we've raised so far, including crowdfunding, about 7 million.
US?
I mean, well, kudos to you, no? It's, I mean, coming out from, you know, going to 20 VCs and not getting any effort and all that, and now you've got quite a number of people backing you up and, you know, moving forward. What are your plans?
My plan is to build a support system, you know, where every family is going to benefit, right? And we want to be able to just grow with the families, right? Where, you know, when children grow, their needs will evolve, we will be there. We want our technology to be, you know, very smart and assistive to the parents.
That's noble.
Yeah, and we want that to happen, right? I mean, you know, last time we were talking about getting more women into workplace, right? And therefore, we're trying to solve that problem of childcare. But now we also see that women are in that sandwich generation where they also have to take care of their elderly parents.
Correct.
So then we shifted also to provide elderly care services, right?
Okay.
So we have childcare and elderly care services. But we also have their children who are now growing up with different needs, you know, and not just care, but also education. And really, we constantly hear about, you know, how do we personalize learning, and we feel that we have this opportunity because we have been with our customers for, you know, since the days that the children were babies. We could actually build a technology that helps to, you know, develop them, you know, in terms of achieving their developmental milestone lah. So that's what we're trying to build now.
Okay, interesting.
So I mean, because you've got such a broad business base now, right? From, I mean, it sounds a bit crude, but cradle to grave, literally, right?
Yes.
So it's also about, as you mentioned earlier, at the beginning, getting caregivers. So I think there's a lot more caregivers who take care of the elderly. I think that's quite an established market.
Industry,
whereas the earlier side, the ones who are taking care, especially the ones, as you mentioned, on demand, in a sense, strangers going to people's houses. Let's zoom in terms of, do you get like a particular caregiver who can take care of children that will take care of elderly? I don't think it works that way, right? It has to be separate.
Actually, we do. We do have both. But the only thing is that they've got to be trained differently. So they have to go through our trainings. Kan? So we've established our Kiddocare Academy, I think over 3 years ago, to make sure that we are able to, you know, all our caregivers go through this training. This is the only way for us to maintain our standards and quality, right?
I see.
But we've also now introduced our elderly caregivers training program. So we have both caregivers who are able to do, you know, single job and both double jobs. Not forgetting our Manny's.
Manny's, yeah. Okay. Wow. Right. So I like this. She has full stack caregivers.
Oh, full stack.
Right? I'm gonna copyright that word.
Okay. I mean, it's pretty interesting, right? End of the day, okay, just in this, something like a one-liner kind of stuff, you know. The general question people would like to ask, you know, basically the trustworthiness, you know, what can you say about that? Everybody, that's a big, big, big question when we talk to a stranger, third party and all that. What can you say about that to people who are keen in this segment?
I think it is important for us to, you know, start looking at the service providers, right? And what they bring to the table. And in this case, it's not just the individual service providers, but the platform that's enabling them, right? So trust is difficult to build, right? And it starts with, learning about both sides, right? And communicating with them, understanding their needs and whatnot. And that's why in Kiddocare, it's very important that we first and foremost establish our standards through our training programs, right? So that's compulsory. They have to go through that, including, you know, PDRM background check, psychometric assessment, health check, and whatnot, right?
So it's a kind of a trademark thing that, you know, it's a proprietary
Kiddocare.
All right, okay.
The second thing is, how do we use technology to solve certain inefficiencies in childcare? And that's one of them is safety, right?
Okay.
How can we use that to monitor? How can we use that to create feedback? So we've put a lot of emphasis into that.
Okay.
And that has somehow become a key, selling point to our customers, because they are able to see what their children are doing on an hourly basis.
Voice
they get
feedback without fear and favor.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes. All right. So always that. And it's, I think it's a work in progress. We've been able to improve certain conditions in the childcare ecosystem. But I think there's a lot more to be done, and we're working very hard on that.
Okay.
The fact that you know your caregivers to that extent, psychometry, you have the essentially criminal record, if
right? Yes. Background checks.
Background checks, right? I mean, you are essentially doing a level of KYC that is above and beyond
correct.
Most companies. I mean, that data alone is valuable, right?
Yes.
I mean, it's something that I guess, of course, you won't see on a camera, but all these tech companies love data of that kind of, that kind of clarity and the sanity checks have been done in that kind of detail, right?
Yes.
Now, you also mentioned that because of the fact that you're 5 years old now, absolutely correct. You could have had a baby, essentially, at the beginning of Kiddocare, who's now 5, turning 6, turning 7. And as a child grows up, their needs change, right?
Yes. And I'm very happy to also share that, you know, our retention rate, our customers have been with us throughout our lifetime. So
Throughout
our lifetime. So customers, retention rate is about 85%.
Wow, that's really impressive. Impressive.
I'm
congratulations.
Actually very proud of the team and the caregivers themselves, you know, for doing such amazing work. And that's how we feel, you know, if you are able to trust your young ones with us, right, as they grow, then we'll, you know, offer ourselves to be the go-to for you lah.
No. For a Manny, or like both of us want to be Manny's, right? For example,
I don't know. Are they going to pass the psychometric assessment or not?
Okay, I'll just go with Adeline.
No, I'm just trying to see the kind of profile, right? Or the persona of a particular caregiver. Do they do this full time? Do they do it part time? How does it? What is your ideal caregiver persona?
Close to 40% of our caregivers actually make this their full time jobs.
Wow!
Right? So when I say full time jobs, you're looking at about between 15 to about 20 days working per month.
Which is full time, right?
I think we've seen a lot of cases where, you know, they come in and try this first, especially women who are in their, you know, young family punya life, right? So they just gotten married, they've got their own kids, and their kids are now going to kindergarten, and they have more time.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and not just that. I think, you know, if you speak to our caregivers who have chosen to do this on a full-time basis, it is also the experience that they have in their work that is contributing back to their families.
I see.
So like, it's, you know, the skills that they have, the experience dealing with other children,
okay.
They can use that in their own families, right?
So it's like training in training.
Yes, training in training. So majority of our full-timers are those of the age of about 25 to about 38. Right? So those are the full-timers.
And they're young families, as you mentioned.
And young families.
What is the split between females versus males?
So we just started hiring or recruiting our male carers last year in August. So male carers, I think now we have about 200. But in total, our caregivers who are registered with us were about 12,000.
12,000?
Yes.
Okay.
That's a huge number.
I mean, before we reach our break, right?
Yeah.
I want to know this. Men, being men, would you trust a male to take care of your kids, right? Because traditionally, you would naturally trust a woman more. It is that sort of mentality because men generally are a bit rough around the edges. How is that sort of kind of... do you get to choose whether you are a Manny or a Danny?
Yes, yes. Okay. Customers have all the right to choose, right? So you get profiles and you can choose from the profile. But many of our customers who chooses the Mannies actually have children who are boys, right? And they're all boys, right? And it's actually very unique, though. Contrary to what you believe, like that men are rough,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I think the data is important. It's quite interesting. Yeah. We want to hear from you before we wrap up.
Yeah.
So, you know, one of our top rated and very highly sought after carer is actually an aeronautical engineer.
What?
Wow. Yeah. So...
And he loves the job and the kind of uniqueness that he brings, you know, during service. So he's more physical in nature, right? So the kids love him because he runs, you know, he does physical activities with the children.
Wow.
And sometimes, you know, the activities that they run with the children, he will create all these science experiments. Wow. So he got volcanoes lah.
Okay.
He teach them coding, you know.
What?
So,
well, this is awesome, yeah?
It's like homeschooling, right?
Exactly, exactly. It's something I really didn't thought of.
It becomes like an enrichment services own home, right? So they all come with different kind of uniqueness and, you know, unique value. And that's where we really want them to go, because Kiddocare is not just about serving families, but making sure that, you know, when they come onto our platform, they would be able to also progress and maybe explore careers in this, you know, industry.
Right, Nadira. I think we'll come back again. You know, let's have a break, and you know, we'll discuss. We'll ask you more questions later on.
Sure.
Right,
and then dive more into
exactly what
makes Nadira the best golfer in the country.
That sharing failures, you know.
I think that's important. Women. That's the most important. Sharing failures.
Yes, because sometimes when you talk about the success too much, right, it feels unattainable when you are at a starting.
Yeah, correct.
You know, at a starting stage, right?
And also the pressure that
the
comes
pressure,
with it, right?
Correct. And they, you know, ask questions that normally men will not be asked. Right. I mean, I've gotten those kind of questions throughout my whole journey, right?
Yep.
So even in my, you know, previous fundraising journey, I had, you know, investors asking me about, you know, how can you commit yourself to this when, you know, you're a mother and you have six children, you know, how are you going to commit to this? I mean, you will never ask a man that question, right? No matter how many children you have,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.